Welcome to St. Charles Presbyterian Church. What a blessing it is that you are with us this morning. I do want to thank Jenny Jadris Wicks, who has agreed to do some of the songs today for us to add to who we are and to help with our worshipful experience. And so what a blessing it is that you all get to experience her like we get to as well. So thank you, Jenny, for doing that. And you will hear from her a couple times later during the service. I do just have a couple of announcements. Is that you really do need to look at the bulletin this week or the newsletter that have been sent to you. So download it and look at that. There's a number of announcements. The deacons are in the midst of continued their ministry and mission to our world and our community. And so they got a couple of collections going on like they do every year. And so we need you to look at that, as well as that. We know that we continue to gather food and donations toward Fort Zumwalt East and their food pantry that are helping how many families, Margaret? 11 families are being helped by our generosity, as well as Fish, the local food pantry, their generosity. So pay attention to all our bulletin announcements as well as in our newsletter this day. As Presbyterians, we are called to be the church reformed, always reforming, according to the word of God and the call of the Holy Spirit. So on this Reformation Sunday, let us prepare our heart to receive God's life-changing word and the Lord's transforming spirit. Let us worship God together.
Good morning. When the Reformation was in full swing in Zurich in the early 1500s, a pandemic struck. Pastor Ulrich Zwingli ministered to his ailing people, and like the psalmist, he discovered confidence in his faith that whether we live or we die, we belong to God. Together in their hymns of faith, let us join in our call to worship. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations.
Help me, O Lord, my strength and rock. Lo, at the door I hear death knock.
Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
Uplift thine arm, once pierced for me, that conquered death and set me free.
Turn, O Lord, how long? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, so that we may rejoice and be glad in all our days.
In faith and hope,
earth I resign, secure of heaven, for I am thine.
The good news this and every single day, God's love has been poured over us to heal and nourish our parched souls. This is the promised land of God's love. This is the place where people are cared for and nurtured. You see, you are loved here. Now we are challenged to go and share Christ's peace and hope and love to a hurting world. So the peace and the love of Christ be with you all.
Let us be prepared to be reformed by God's word. Lord, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We need not stumble in darkness nor fear the night, because you send your Son to be the light of the world. In this hour of worship, we ask to be illumined by your wisdom and will through the power of your living word read and proclaimed. Amen. Our Old Testament lesson from the last book of the Torah, Deuteronomy, chapter 34, verses 1 through 12, See now Moses' view from the mountaintop overlooking the promised land and learn from his wisdom. Sometime later, Moses left the lowlands of Moab. He went up to Mount Pisgah to the peak of Mount Nebo, which is across the Jordan River from Jericho. The Lord showed him all the land as far north as Gilead and the town of Dan. He let Moses see the territories that would soon belong to the tribes of Naphtali, Ephraim, Manasseh, and Judah, as far west as the Mediterranean Sea. The Lord also showed him the land in the south, from the valley near the town of Jericho, known as the City of Palm Trees, down to the town of Zorah. The Lord said, "Moses, this is the land I was talking about when I solemnly promised Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that I would give land to their descendants. I have let you see it, but you will not cross the Jordan and go in." And so Moses, the Lord's servant, died there in Moab, just as the Lord had said. The Lord buried him in a valley near the town of Beth Peor, but even today no one knows exactly where. Moses was 120 years old when he died, yet his eyesight was still good and his body was strong. The people of Israel stayed in the lowlands of Moab, where they mourned and grieved 30 days for Moses, as was their custom. Before Moses died, he had placed his hands on Joshua, and the Lord had given Joshua wisdom. The Israelites paid attention to what Joshua said and obeyed the commands that the Lord had given Moses. There has never again been a prophet in Israel like Moses. The Lord spoke face to face with him and sent him to perform powerful miracles in the presence of the king of Egypt and his entire nation. No one else has ever had the power to do such great things as Moses did for everyone to see. May these words inspire our faith toward the future God imagines for us and the world. Amen.
Our lectionary gospel lesson on this Reformation Sunday comes to us from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 34 through 46. Jesus, like Moses, faces the future, looking out toward the horizon, and he's trying to help his people go to the promised land that they are heading toward. And these are the words that he leaves to us as we journey every single day to the place where God calls us. Matthew 22, verses 34 through 46. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher," he asked, "which commandment in the law is the greatest?" And Jesus said to this man, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest in the first commandment. And the second is just like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the laws and the prophets." Now, while the Pharisees were gathered there, Jesus asked them this question: "What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he?" And they said, "The son of David." And Jesus said to them, "How is it then that David, by the Spirit, calls him Lord, saying, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at the right hand until I put your enemies under your feet'? If David calls thus him the Lord, how can he be his son?" And no one was able to give him an answer, nor from what day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. My friends, these commandments are ours to build us up into the body of Christ. And the people of God said, "Thanks be to God." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you command us to remember that the first commandment is to love God with all that we are, our hearts, our souls, our minds, our spirits. The second is equal to this, in that this love is to be extended to our neighbors. So in the words that we've read and those now shared, help us to internalize these commandments and be reminded of your everlasting love for us. For it's in Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. In just 9 days, our country will face one of its most important elections in our entire history. And during a pandemic, our country has never really experienced before. Our future that we're trying to see and predict is fuzzy at best. So what are we to do during this turbulent time in which we now live? This morning, our scripture invites us to join Moses and Jesus as they also look to an unknown future. And I think Moses felt some of the same feelings that we have this morning as he stood on that mountaintop and looked toward Canaan. You see, he had shepherded an emerging nation. He had brought them from no people to a verge of a brand new homeland. But he himself will not be able to set foot on the ground that inspired his dreams. He has prepared for a world, a promise that he knows that he will never see. Centuries later, Martin Luther was asked, "If the world was to end tomorrow, what would you do?" And listen to his response. He responded, "I would plant a tree." And what he is saying is that we may never enjoy or see the fruits of our actions and labor, but by faithful living, we have the ability to actually shape the future for our children and those that we love so dearly. You see, hope enables us to trust that God will use our finite lives as contributors to an everlasting adventure. Today's passage reminds us that what we do today truly matters and shapes a future we may never actually see or experience. Today is Reformation Sunday, and we look forward to All Saints Day just right around the corner. And we are reminded by both of these events that the saints let go of their self and their short time span of life to embrace the well-being of future generations. As we celebrate Reformation Sunday, I'd like to give you a little recap on the fundamentals of the 16th century Reformation in case you don't know what that's all about. To begin with, the founders of a Reformed faith, Martin Luther, Ulrich Zwingli, John Calvin, and others, had no idea what their legacy would be as they led their people through their own turbulent time as a church and as a people of God. And all they wanted is for the people of faith to follow the gospel by relying solely on the unmerited grace of God, and not on the religious structures and the rules of their day. Their message invited people to live in the spirit of a new creation, a new mountaintop vision where people were set free of legalism and an openness to love one another in response of God's love for us. And over time and their lives, four important theological principles emerge from these early reformers that still are at the heart of our Reformed faith. And you can actually see them on this morning's bulletin cover, and hopefully, some of you will remember them from some of my Reformation sermons in the past years. If not, here are the vision of the Reformed and always Reforming Church that they dreamed of. The first is about totally the grace of the Lord. Luther was inspired by Romans 5, and he nailed his thoughts to the Wittenberg Chapel door. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And what he was proclaiming in his 95 Theses is that grace abounds. God loves you, forgives you, and you don't have to earn it. Amazing grace. The second is Scripture. Sola gratia, only grace. Sola scriptura, only Scripture. These were the early mottos of the Reformation. You see, they believed that the Bible is the living Word of God, the guidepost for the church and her mission, revealing God's movements in history as well as presence in our lives today. You see, it's to be used as a guidebook, a searchlight on the journey of our faith, inspiring us to see God's vision in our time and in our place. The third cornerstone of their faith is the priesthood of believers. This simply means that every Christian has a role in God's plan as the body of Christ, where we actually get to be God's companions and messengers sharing the good news in our daily life. Finally, from their vision on the horizon of the Reformation, the Reformers proclaimed this: Reformation is always reforming. And what that means is that God is constantly creating and challenges us to become creators as well. But moving forward by grace and wisdom and trusting the visions that God gives us. And this shouldn't be a surprise to us, right? Because it's exactly what we see in this morning's scripture lessons, especially our lesson that Margaret read from Deuteronomy. So you see, Moses had a vision of a land guided by justice, united by a common cause, and living with the vision of God's constant presence and love. It's in that kind of spirit we, as we face an unknown future with the hopes of a promised land, of a better tomorrow, that celebrates religious visions that inspire us to do justice by loving God with all that we are, and by celebrating and honoring diversity and differences, by loving our neighbors as we do ourselves. But like Moses taught us, the job is often left unfinished, right? You see, the Protestant reformers often asserted that the Reformed Church is always reforming. And for us, that means we need to look forward toward the horizon, knowing that new possibilities are going to emerge with each small step that we take. You see, we build our faith on a faith that leans toward the future God imagines for us and our world. Even when we aren't actually on a mountaintop, but we're actually feels like we're in a chasm and can't see exactly what that future might hold. We continue this thought as we look to the gospel reading. Jesus is asked a gotcha question because the religious leaders, threatened by his popularity, wanted to trap and actually discredit him. But Jesus, like he often does, turns the table on them. And he reminds them of the beginning law of love that was given to them from Moses from years and years and decades before, but they had forgotten to actually put into the practice of their life. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your mind and your entire self. Put God first, in other words, and let your relationship with God determine your every single day and your long-term values. Put God in every plan that you make and pray for God and to know where God wants you to be and what God wants you to do. And we think that would be enough, right? But Jesus isn't finished. And he adds, love your neighbor as yourself. Get over yourself, in other words, and go from self-interest to care for others in your lives. Jesus doesn't tell us exactly how to care for our neighbors, but he tells us through his life and his ministry that we need to be neighbors responding to the pain and hurting and suffering of people that we come in contact every single day. Today on Reformation Sunday, even though all of us would love to forget the year 2020, right? We need to recall those moments when we have been filled and we had dreams of a better world, a more noble self, a deeper faith, as people of God, as well as communities in which we live and worship. And what this means is that we need to look beyond our self-interest, our own national interest, because what Moses, Jesus, and the reformers all taught us is that these are pitfalls of the death of churches, of communities, of nations, and eventually our planet itself. See, we need to begin to imagine a different world, a better world than the current divisive and violent one in which we now live. This week, I read a great story about a meeting between high-ranking political leaders and church leaders that were serious about social justice. And these faith-filled visionaries counseled the politicians by saying, it's our job to tell you to let justice roll down like waters, and it's your job to begin to build the ditches. You see, we need both idealists and concrete thinkers. visionaries, and activists. I mean, maybe none of us can be like Moses or Jesus or even Martin Luther or Martin Luther King and get to the mountaintop to be able to see what the future holds after COVID is gone, elections are in the rearview mirror, and the social and racial unrest find peaceful solutions. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't be working down in the valley, building a road to the promised land for our children and our grandchildren and our neighbors who are hurting and needing our care and our guidance. And the reason we do this is exactly like Martin Luther taught us and Jesus showed us. It's all about grace. You see, we love God because God first loved us. And that means we're not just receivers of God's grace, but called to be givers as well. Anything less than that is cheap grace. As Dietrich Bonhoeffer asserted, cheap grace means we receive everything from God and do absolutely nothing in return. Today, our reformers remind us that yes, God loves us. And despite the messiness of our lives, we're supposed to share the good news with the world through our daily living and the mission and ministry of Christ's church. And like most of you know, even though our building might be closed, St. Charles Presbyterian Church is alive and active and continues to be the good news church, reformed and always reforming. Beloved, on this Reformation Day 2020, it's my prayer as your pastor, your brother in Christ, and your lifelong friend, that you could be open to something new in your life. You see, now is the time to live the spirit of a new creation, a new beginning. So yeah, treasure tradition and let us share the very best of it as the reformers did. But I encourage you to try new things. Suggest new ways for us to be faithful here at this church. Be open to whatever the future is going to look like for us as a church. And look for new healthy behaviors that will bring about the joy and the peace and the hope and the justice to our neighbors. And let's begin to build foundations for the roads we will need for our future, to the future promised land, wherever and whatever that might be. Let us pray. God of the mountaintop, in prayer you walk with us to the highest point, from which we are able to see the new world as you see it, the world as you wish it to be. God of also the valleys, you teach us to draw our eyes in the valleys from our concerns to those of our neighbors, our community, and our world. Give us such visions of yours so that our lives may be reformed as we offer others an image of your love shown by our faith in Jesus. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Faith in the Reformed tradition teaches us that a faithful steward shuns ostentation and seeks proper use of the gifts of God's creation. Swiss theologian Karl Barth builds on this theology when he said, "Grace and gratitude go together like heaven and earth." You see, all of us are called to share our blessings. So may the offerings we bring this day and the prayers we offer for one another be a sign of our commitment to be known by our love, as well as our grace and gratitude.
Part of the Reformed tradition is that the priesthood of believers means that each of us have a responsibility to share the good news, which means that we do that through our hearts and our hands. And that means through actual visible actions, like when we collect for the Angel Tree or collect cards for St. Charles High School and the Alternative School, or collect food for Fort Zumwalt East. But we also then, if we physically can't do stuff, we always can pray for one another. And so this is the time that we lift up our family and friends as a people of God. And so we're so grateful for our church family. And so we work our way through our church directory today. We remember Sally Stumberg. We also remember Lou and D. Ted. As many of you have been told, Lou actually has lung cancer. And the good news, it's really small. They've been watching it. It hasn't gone anywhere else. So he's scheduled for surgery, I believe, like next week. And so he's having to be separated from D because the place they live is where you're not allowed to come and go. And so he's staying with his daughter at this point. But he's doing well, and we pray that the surgery goes well for him. We also remember Mike and Bev Wade, as well as my buddy Tommy. I miss Tommy in the worst way. It's Mike's special brother that he has, and so we know that we're thinking of them. And especially their service to the country that they have given, and as well as their care that they're giving Tommy during this time. We're also praying for in Giddings Love Joy Presbytery. This is our regional body that cares for us. Is First Presbyterian Church there in historic St. Geneva, and their pastor is Reverend Stephen Matthews, and we know they have a long history there of being really kind of the hub of St. Genevieve, so remember them. And I'm also mindful, as I've paid attention to our COVID numbers and the newspapers, and some alarming things are happening. Our hospitals are really filling up, and I just heard from the task force director there for the St. Louis region, and he says that their beds are almost full, and it's just not with COVID patients, it's with all sorts of patients. And our region is sending people like from smaller towns to the hospital, and they're actually turning those people away because they don't have room, and they know the COVID numbers are rising. And I heard also that Kansas City are just flat out, most of the hospitals in Kansas City are just turning away every ambulance that shows up because they have no beds at all in their hospitals. So I just pray for wisdom right now. For our leaders, and especially those frontline workers that we really focused on them early and how stressed out they were. Well, this has been a long journey for them, and now the numbers are even getting higher than it was when we were so concerned about them. So pray for our nurses and those who clean the hospitals and the doctors and the technicians that are there. This is a very stressful time, and we just pray for, again, a peace, but real practical ways that we could slow this down in our community and across the country and our world. So we remember all those things. And so look to your directory and as well as your bulletin and to remember who we're thinking of. There's so many more that we're remembering this day. But I am very thankful that Jenny was here today to share her gifts with us. I think it was added such a blessing, and I think we're going to see a lot more of that during these recorded times, so you can begin to see all the different family members that we have. So if you have a gift that you want to share, that's musical in some way, don't hesitate to let us know. We'd love for you to turn around and record with us. And if you can't be here, you can maybe record and send it to me or Greg, and we'll get you part of our worship service that you view on Sunday that we record on Saturday. So knowing that we have been reformed, but we continue to be reformed and reforming, let us go to God who transforms and reforms our life in prayer. Lord, you have blessed the works of our hands and given us resources and talents to share in your service. You entrusted us with gifts to share for the reforming of our world. We rejoice that you enlist us to participate in the priesthood of all believers and the care of all your creation. So we celebrate this day, your Spirit, in our world, in our lives, and through the gifts we give to you in faith and hope. Bless them and use them in ways we may never see, but trust they will be used for your future. So Almighty God, as the days shorten, the leaves fall from the trees, we are wondering what tomorrow is going to bring us. I mean, we're certain of your love for us, no matter what challenges us. And we trust your promise to never abandon us and your power to uphold us all our days. But still we marvel that you choose to be in relationship with us, calling us to be your hearts and hands to a world that needs us. We're told through Scripture that you're the beginning and the end of all things, the Alpha and the Omega. There's nothing that you aren't part of, that doesn't belong to you, that's not loved by you. So confident in this never-changing character of mercy and kindness, we do pray now to you, laying bare our hopes, our fears, and the longing of our hearts. Bring to mind those for whom you would have us pray, both with our hearts and our hands in real ways, and also with the words of our lips. Remind us, especially this day, that when one part of the body hurts, we all suffer until the time that we all could rejoice and celebrate together. God, what we heard today is that you are the God of the seen as well as the unseen. And you give us your commandments that we might live in ways that reflect amazing love and grace, so others might have the same abundant life that we experience. All the law and the prophets is summed up in loving you with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbors as ourselves. So we ask, therefore, that our love of you and one another be tangible and transformative. So send your Spirit that enables us to practice mutual forgiveness, radical hospitality, generous mercy, and relentless kindness. Loving God, we pause now to rest in the peace that only you can give in the presence of your holy arms. We ask that we might be bold witness and strengthened by such love, that our humble service might be for the sake of all that you've done for us, as we walk to the promised land of an unknown future. We join in the prayer that brings us and makes us one by praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not in temptation, deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, as God's chosen ones, reformed and always reforming, clothe yourself with compassion and kindness and humility and meekness and patience. Bear with one another, and above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And as Jesus taught us, when we love God and our neighbors, everything changes. So go forth in this aching and hurting world with God's love, offering healing and hope and peace to everyone you meet. Go in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.